ആക്ച്വലി സുനിലിനെ പറയുന്നത് എന്റെ മനസ്സിലിങ്ങനെ ഫ്രോസനായിരുന്നു. സുനിലിനെ എന്റെ സീനിയറായിട്ട് ഞാൻ പരിചയപ്പെട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട് 1994 സുനില്. പിന്നെ വളരെ കുറച്ച് ഞങ്ങൾ ഇടപെടുത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ എന്റെ മനസ്സിൽ ഫ്രോസനായിരുന്നു. പക്ഷെ ഓർമ്മകളും ഹൃദയത്തിന്റെ ഭാഷയെ സംസാരിക്കുമ്പം നിങ്ങളുടെ എല്ലാം മനസ്സിനോട് ഒരുപാട് അടുത്ത് നിൽക്കുന്ന സുനിലായി പെട്ടെന്ന് എനിക്ക് ഓർമ്മ വന്നു. യു നോ ഹി റാക്ട് മീ ഇൻ 1994 വെൻ ഐ ജോയിൻഡ് കാര്യവട്ടം. സോ ദേർ ഈസ് ലൈക്ക് യു നോ ദേ വേസ് മൈ സീനിയേഴ്സ്. അപ്പോൾ വൺ വീക്ക് ദേ ആസ്റ്റ് ടു ഡു സർട്ടൻ റെസ്ട്രിക്ഷൻസ്. സീനിയേഴ്സിൻ്റെ ക്ലാസ് റൂമിൻ്റെ കവാടത്തിൻ്റെ മുന്നിൽ കൂടെ നടക്കരുത്, കുഞ്ഞു കുഞ്ഞു കാര്യങ്ങൾ ചെയ്യുന്ന ചെറിയ ചെറിയ കാര്യങ്ങൾ. സുനിൽ വാസ് വെരി സ്ട്രോങ് കുട്ടി നടക്കരുത്. സോ എനിക്ക് എൻ്റെ മനസ്സിൻ്റെ സുനിൽ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ആ കാര്യവട്ടത്തെ സുനിലാണ്. എന്നിട്ട് ഹിസ് ഫ്രണ്ട് ആസ്ക്ഡ് മീ ദാറ്റ് സംതിങ് സം യൂണിവേഴ്സിലെ ഏതോ ഒരു കാര്യം അവൻ്റെ മനസ്സിനെ ഹിറ്റ് ചെയ്തു. ഹി നീഡ് മീ ടു സോൾവ് ദ ഇഷ്യൂ എന്ന രീതിയില്ല. ഹിസ് ഫ്രണ്ട് മൈ സീനിയർ കോൾഡ് മീ ടു വാക്ക് ത്രൂ ദാറ്റ് കൊറിഡോർ. ദെൻ ഹി വാസ് ചീറ്റിംഗ് മീ. ഹി ടോൾഡ് മീ ടു ഡിസോബീഡിയന്റ് ഹി വാക്ക്ഡ് ത്രൂ ദാറ്റ്. ദെൻ സുനിൽ പറഞ്ഞു ഈ ജോഡി കുട്ടിനെ വിളിക്കണം, യു ഗോ ആൻഡ് ടു മീറ്റ് ദ ജോഡി. ദെൻ രാമചന്ദ്രൻ സർ വാസ് അവർ ഈ ജോഡി. സോ സാറ് വിളിച്ചിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞു ദർ ആർ സർട്ടൻ തിങ്സ് ഓൺ ബോർഡ് ഹിയർ, ആഫ്റ്റർ ദാറ്റ് യു ആർ എക്സാക്ട്ലി യു നീഡ് ടു ഒബേ ദാറ്റ്, ഡോണ്ട് റിവോൾട്ട്. സോ ഹി വാസ് ഹാൻഡ്ലിങ് ദാറ്റ്. സുനിൽ ഇത് ദിസ് വാസ് മൈ എൻകൗണ്ടർ. പിന്നെ ഒരു റാഗിൽ കഴിഞ്ഞ എത്രത്തോളം കൂട്ടുകാരാകാൻ പറ്റും, ഒരുമിച്ച് ജീവിക്കാൻ പറ്റും എന്നൊക്കെയുള്ളത് ദെൻ ദ നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഇയർ. You know, he was my second year. And above Sunil and I were looking at the library, and the Ushaman was our librarian. Sunil and I were my father and my father. So, at that time, I was in the Sunil and Sunil was teaching and I was in the library. So, Madhuram Jima was in the library, and I was in the library. I was in the library, and I was in the library. ഉള്ളുന്ന് പാടുന്ന സുനിലിനെയാണ് ഓർമ്മ വരുന്നത്. സുനിലൊക്കെയാണ് സുനിലിനെ കുറിച്ചുള്ള എൻ്റെ ഓർമ്മകൾ. ഇനി എങ്ങനെ വളർന്നു വലുതായി ആകാനുള്ള മനുഷ്യൻ അതൊന്നും ആദ്യം എനിക്ക് കാണാൻ പറ്റില്ല, നമ്മൾ ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്തിട്ടില്ല. സോ ഹാപ്പി ടു ദാറ്റ് ഹൃദയത്തിൻ്റെ ഭാഷയിൽ എല്ലാവരും സംസാരിച്ചപ്പോൾ സന്തോഷം തോന്നി. പെട്ടെന്ന് ഇങ്ങനെ എൻ്റെ മനസ്സിൽ ഫ്രോസനായിട്ട് ഒരു വ്യക്തി തിരിച്ചെത്തിയേക്ക് വന്നു. So now let me focus on my degree. Anna asked me to talk about the Indian growth story, and a special thanks to Uma ma'am that we are in charge here. It's because of Uma that we are together and I'm here. So growth story, when I think about the growth story, you know, there are a lot of downside risk. We cannot celebrate that 7-8% growth story put forward by the multilateral agencies and even the predictions. And recently there was a macrofiscal seminar happened in NIPFP, and using the high frequency models, my colleague Rudrani Bhattacharya, she also predicted, and it is a hard work, the assumptions, the models, she has done a lot of work. And she also predicted that it is 7.1. But can we celebrate this growth? What are the challenges? So that's the way I'm going to focus my lecture today. When I think about the downside risk, you know, poly crisis is very important. Now we know that the world is passing through multiple crises, and we have wars, and we have geopolitical uncertainties. And one Western central bank is increasing the interest rates. So if one central bank is increasing the interest rates, that central bank is inducing the entire world, especially the emerging economies, into recession. And we can't help it. Unless we match up with their increasing interest rates, then the capital is going to be flighty and the global inflation is mounting. So this is the moment the policymakers anywhere in the world, not only in India, they're undergoing a very tough job. If you look at Central Bank or if you look at the ministries or the finance or the fiscal policy authorities, no one is okay now because we are passing through multiple crises. And what is the decision we need to focus is a challenge. It's not easy and it's a dynamic world. And when I talk about this poly crisis, it's not only about one central bank increasing the interest rates, the global inflation and the climate crisis which is happening right now, which we need to address. Along with that, there are many supply chain shocks as well. Supply chain shocks in the sense, what is happening with the waters. The Suez Canal is not functioning now. Red Sea is not functioning now. It's taking a longer route through Cape of Good Hope to, the consignments are getting delayed. So it's all, adding to the fuel. And we need to, address these issues. On one side, the globe is in a recessionary trend. On the other side, there is mounting inflation. So what is the combination right now by the policymakers on the fiscal authorities or the monetary authorities to tackle this crisis? How we have done the deal, if you look into it, it's an understanding that the fiscal policymakers who is dealing with the fiscal in the sense who is dealing with the government, they are keeping the policies very accommodative to tackle the growth recovery process. At the same time, the central bank is keeping the interest rates to tackle inflation. So it's a kind of a policy coordination that's happening right now to tackle the growth recovery process. And take a look into the recent publication by IMF. It is clearly deciphered that US has not hit the recession the way we thought it was going to hit, because the policy from the fiscal side was very accommodative. So in the post-pandemic fiscal space, the way they designed, it has done a little bit of overheating, but that helped, that they didn't go into the recession. But we need to see what is happening in the future. Despite Jay Powell, the central bank chief of the country, kept the interest rates higher. Why low interest rate is important for the growth recovery process? Then we get the investment cheaper, the credit recovery process will happen, the credit infusion will happen, and it is easy to do an economic growth recovery process if the interest rates are lower. But interest rate is mounting. That is affecting the emerging world. In the sense, if you don't do an interest rate defense to keep up with the Western world's interest rate, the capital, the hot money will be flighty, the mounting global inflation we will not be able to tackle, and the financialization of savings in the Indian economy recently, we are talking about the preventing savings in the economy. So the savings will not be okay. So there are a lot of crises, and the important thing is negative interest rates. What exactly is negative interest rate? We deposit some money in the bank. If the inflation is mounting, we are not even getting what we have deposited. So the chief of the central bank or the central bank authorities are very worried about negative interest rate. So we need to tackle that. So the country has now decided that, okay, officially, what could be the inflation that can be maintained in a country? So they have their own vision. So we thought that up to 4% is okay for growth. In US, they thought that up to 2% may be okay. So the central bank authorities now continuously planning and implementing how they can maintain that nominal inflation anchor. At the same time, the fiscal policy authorities are now keeping the fiscal policy accommodative. And accommodative is a huge word. In Kerala also, we kept the fiscal policy accommodative, but we have not taken it in a good spirit. What is accommodative fiscal space? When the interest rates are lower, you can afford to have little high deficit or high debt. That is accommodative fiscal space. If you don't do an accommodative fiscal space by curtailing the debt and deficit, that will lead to the growth repercussions, negative growth repercussions. So you keep your fiscal policy accommodative. We don't have any other way. But if you keep your fiscal policy accommodative, yesterday we were talking about this debate, you can't do fiscal policy.
profligacy. If you're keeping the fiscal policy accommodative, tied to infrastructure investment or tied to reduce the output gap. Again, this output gap is taking me back to the point we are discussing, that there is a gap, like human beings, there's a gap in the economy from potential and actual. So what you are realizing that is the gap very close. It's very important to look into. So econometricians, they have a tough time in predicting the potential output of a country. Potential output in the sense you have to visualize the frontier or the way in which a country can grow up to. But that is an unobserved variable for an economist. So they do a lot of models and arrive at a variable which capture that potential. In the sense, in a very simple manner, if I explain that, your growth, personal growth, you just visualize this personal growth. We have cyclicality, and if you look at the past 10 years, we have a trend also. Our teachers will not, ask us what are you doing, what's happening to you, just because of the cyclicality in the marks. We just think about the potential of a student. So that's about the cyclicality. And our parents also don't scold us, like if there is a minor variations, because home is not built in a day, one exam will not do anything. So like that, the economy, we have to test it. So long term is okay, the trend is okay, it's fine. So we take out the cyclicalities and call that trend as the potential. And this analytical narrative about the growth process is based on the assumption that the economy experiences business cycles. Business cycles means, we can understand this upturn and downturn. But in the context of emerging countries, recently the empirical evidence proved that economy won't experience business cycles just like the way we imagine. Then the policymakers' job is getting tougher. Because if the economy is experiencing business cycles, then the policymaker can do the counter-cyclical activity. If it's in the low term, fiscal policy and monetary authorities will do some pump priming or keep the interest rate lower. That is counter-cyclical, so that the economy will go to the upturn. So this counter-cyclical narrative of a policy making, whether it is fiscal or monetary, is not working anymore because we are not sure about we can date the business cycles. So that's the analytical challenge. If we can't date the business cycles perfect, what is the focus of a policy maker? They should be focusing on the structural reforms. And we have done that. If you look into the fiscal process, there is another important constraint we are operating right now is we have to operate within a threshold ratio of the deficit. So if you have a threshold ratio, how are you going to help the growth recovery process? Because you always think about the fiscal consolidation. So whether the consolidation you are doing and the growth, they are moving together, or whether the consolidation is hurting the growth is the next hypothetical question of the research question we can ask, whether fiscal discipline is growth promoting. Fiscal discipline is not growth promoting. Because the way we do the fiscal discipline, mostly in many countries, they curtail the spending to reach that 3% of the deficit. In the sense, how you maintain the deficit, you have revenue and the expenditure. So you have to either have the taxes void or you have to reduce your spending. And in an economy, most of the times, in the uncertain times, when the taxes are not void, we curtail the spending. So now, central government is on fiscal consolidation path by reducing the revenue expenditure. There's a serious compression in the revenue expenditure, and the taxes, little bit of buoyancy is there. But mainly, it is tied to the capital spending in the economy. So the narrative is like, you have high fiscal deficit of debt. We are using it for infrastructure spending, and that's going to crowd in the private investment. But private investment is shy. So if you do a determining investment model, you have to understand what are the important variables. How much is your public investment a significant determinant in getting the prime to this thing, you need to look. And you need to control for many other variables. So there are many things. So why there is no one-to-one attraction or attractiveness of public investment and private investment, it's high time to look into. So the models predictive in saying it's not instantaneously, wait, things will happen with a lag effect. So that's where, you know, that investment story is going. Now look at the external effect. There is no retreat of globalization right now. If you look into the capital account and the current account in simple terms is the gap between the X and Y, the imports and the exports. So that gap, there are theories which say that you live up within 2% of the current account deficit, it's growth inducing. But if you reduce it much, it can affect growth. Okay, but we can't maintain 4%. In Rajan's period, not we went up to 4%, X minus M. But conveniently, we were financing that imports minus exports gap with the capital flows, with the capital account. Then the capital starts becoming flighty. Because of the high interest rates of the Western world, we started getting panic. And then we did the interest rate defense. The rupee fall happened, but continuous intervention of RBI in the currency markets didn't help. We tried capital controls, that didn't help. So the only sustainable way in which we could do was interest rate defense, and we are likely doing that. And there is no neutral stance, it's only withdrawal of accommodative stance. So that's the way the RBI is doing. Now, when I talk about these interest rates, we also need to look into the term structure of interest rates, the relationship between the short run rate of interest and the long run rate of interest is related. It's always moving together, and the yield curve will smile or yield curve will not smile, whether there's an inversion in yield curve. These are important questions we ask when we talk about the term structure of the interest rate. And now that's a serious question, whether the short run rates are going higher or not. So what Kerala has done brilliantly is that we have done an elongation of the debt maturity structure. In the sense, if I have more long-term debt, I am getting enough space to undertake robust economic growth process. But if the economy is the debt maturity structure is short term, then there is a rollover risk. And there is no rollover risk in the context of India or Kerala. And Telangana is done much smarter. 40% of their debt maturity structure is long-term, and that is a new state, and they have a huge path, promise group path in front of them. So these are the ways in which we are tackling. Now, Western world talks about a hidden debt. When we want to keep the fiscal deficit accommodative, the hidden debt started mounting. And the hidden debt is nothing but you go out of the budget limits and get into the debt process or the borrowing process to maintain the infrastructure. And this hidden debt is leading to fiscal risk, and now it's a big question, even in the context of Kerala or the Western world. The hidden debt is an important issue. Then we need to ask a question. How do you measure the gap, the macroeconomic gap of the resources and the spending, whether the fiscal deficit is enough or whether we need to invent new kinds of deficit concepts like public sector borrowing requirement in which hidden debt can be absorbed. You know, we have to rethink about the concepts of deficit. And one main thing is the golden principle. Golden principle is we need to keep the revenue deficit zero. Revenue surplus, the advantage is that your earnings and your spending will be equal. That's the way you maintain the zero revenue deficit. But whatever you borrow, that will be going for the productive capital spending or capital infrastructure. So that's the way we visualize that we need to keep the revenue deficit zero. But in the uncertain times, zero revenue deficit is not plausible if the revenue receipts are, giving much returns. Now, when we think about the growth recovery process and the fiscal policy being accommodative, what is announced in the budget is not enough. In the budget, we may come up with a lot of numbers. The budget credibility question is yet another. We can dream of many things that we can get into, a lot of promises that we are going to have tax collections up to 13%. We are going to have high spending in the economy. But the size of the government, that's a tricky question. The percentage of the revenue spending to GDP. And the size of the government and the poly crisis, these are closely correlated. So you need to look into the size of government. At the same time, the budget credibility tells you that whatever is promised in the budget, it was not getting translated into better, you know, variables or better numbers. You need to understand that what is promised in the budget is not backed up by proper allocation, or what is promised in the budget as tax collection is not exactly collected by the government. So there are serious errors in the fiscal forecasting. These are important issues to be looked into, because the numbers in the budget doesn't say everything. So budget transparency, budget accountability are equally important when we talk about an accommodative fiscal space. So these are the concerns. So what are the good things that has happened and what are the bad things? Good things in the sense, there was a continuity in the macroeconomic process in India. 10 years, there was a different party in regime. Prior to 10 years, we focused on many entitlements-based fiscal policies or entitlement-based public policies. And there was a continuity in that policies of the government. That's a beautiful thing. What has not worked, he's recording the meeting, what has not worked is the radical revolution or radical reforms that we have done in Indian economy in terms of less research demonetization. GST, there are ugly, good and bad elements. The way we implemented contain little bit of ugly elements which we need to, but it's a good flavor. That's why I told that GST has good, bad and ugly elements. So we need to understand that GST per se is not bad. What is the problem in the implementation, in dealing with the multiplicity of the rates and how to do the ease of filing or ease of doing business. And demonetization, we need to look into the Indian economy. 96% of the Indian economy is in the unorganized sector or informal sector where we don't have any data. So we don't know the stated objectives of the demonetization. Whether we have attained that status objectives, we are not sure. The state, and also how much the forced formalization of the Indian economy has wiped out the informal sector. So these are the questions. And if you ask me if we have empirical evidence to show that the demonetization worked well or not, we have one study by Geeta Gopinath. Then, you know, students know that in the below state, if you want to work, we don't have an economic growth variable. We need to proxy certain things to understand how the economy grows. We don't have GDP below state. So it's interesting that Geeta Gopinath and her team use the satellite data, the intensity of the night lights, to understand the growth process and study the impact of demonetization. You know, you can say that is this the methodology, it's an approved methodology or not. You can ask how the growth is proxied, but that's a way that demonetization is studied, and we don't have any evidence that the stated objectives taking out the counterfeit currency or absorbing the black money, because black money is not the stock, right? It's a flow concept. So how much that is met, how much formalization of the economy has happened. So whatever they stated, nothing has happened. This is an area of concern. Second area of concern is digital divide and digital infrastructure in contributing or in determining the growth process. There, when you talk about the digital divide, we have to tackle the digital divide first before getting into the digital currency or the digital infrastructure. In the Indian economy, if you ask me, whether there is a formalization or whether the people are getting access to the formal credit markets because of the digital infrastructure, my answer is yes and no. And when we talk about the digital currency or the digital dollar, advantage is that it leads to financial inclusion, because we don't have many bank branches penetrations in the remote areas. So digital, that will help for financial inclusion process. But at the same time, it can also lead to some kind of lack of trust models. It can also lead to some problems with the cross-border transactions. unless we have a clear regulatory framework. And I know that some of you started investing in crypto. And if you want to do an authentic crypto deal, then we should have a regulatory framework on board so that we won't get into the fish coins, right? Something, some regulatory framework is required to take out the fish coins. But philosophically, if you ask me whether speculation needs to be encouraged in the Indian economy or not, whether that is growth inducing or not, it's a personal take. People do speculate, but my call is not related to the speculation. But what I'm talking about is the regulatory framework which is required to ease the transactions with the high risk, high return assets if people want to invest in that. But what we have done is we have announced 30% tax will be done on the crypto transactions, but the taxation is not making the things legitimate, because any other speculation, speculative assets in Indian economy is taxed at 30%, whether it is horse race, casino, or whatever it is. It is a speculation that is getting taxed, but it is not making the things legitimate. This case was put forward in the G20. What could be the multilateral architecture we require for this crypto deals? So that question was taken with much significance in the G20 meeting, which is happening in the New Delhi. Another important thing for the growth process which we need to look into is climate. Because we can't do anything unless we incorporate a climate resilient public policy. So what we have done, the public policy challenges related to climate, what we have done, there is no coordination or consensus among the macroeconomists when we talk about the climate change. In the sense, monetary policy authorities, if you ask to look into the climate change, they can always say that our mandate within the new monetary framework, our mandate is looking into the inflation. It's not getting into the climate change commitments, because the tools and the methodologies and the space of the political economy question of climate change that can lead to the reputation risk of the central bank. So we will not get into that. This was a take by many economists. If you ask about the climate change scale, what are we going to do about the climate change commitments? But at the same time, some sprouts are there in the sense the European Central Bank, even RBI, they started thinking about how to do the greening of monetary policy, how it can be climate resilient when we talk about the growth. So one important methodology is stress test. You ask the investors, top investors, to go for a climate resilient stress test, because these climate related risk and uncertainties will get into the financial instabilities later. So it is your call to look into the climate change related risk and uncertainties before you start talking about your NDAs or your financial instabilities. That's one thing. How the fiscal policy authorities got into the climate change commitments? If you ask me, do we have a climate budget? Do we announce in advance that how much India is spending on the climate change commitments? The answer is no. We don't have a clear framework related to climate. And what is done in India is we have national adaptation communication. We need to do that because of the COP28 and 29 commitments. There, NIPFP was asked to do a study. There was a steering committee where I worked. So they identified some 8 components of the adaptation related spending for the first time ever in India. And we need to map the demand for grants or the allocations to these 8 components related to the climate change. So that was the first ever exercise. It came to 5% of GDP, what India is spending on the climate change commitments. So that's the way. Now, what could be an alternative tool if the RBI is shy, if the ministry is not coming up with a climate responsive budgeting? What could be the other or important tool in which we can talk about the climate change commitments? One important tool is we need to get into the intergovernmental fiscal transfers. 16th Finance Commission is just constituted. So intergovernmental fiscal transfer, when we think about a fiscal federalism model, IGFT is a huge space to operate. And with IGFT, if you ask me, the climate-related concerns are incorporated. Yes and no. They have a climate component within the IGFT formula, and that's given a slight weightage. So So if you ask me whether ecological fiscal transfer is recognized in the context of India, my answer is yes. But if it is significant, then we need to do work and miles to go. So these are the concerns. The currency is getting digital. Ecological fiscal transfers or the climate resilient fiscal system or monetary system is quite relevant. So these are the new challenges which we need to think about when we talk about the growth recovery process. Now, we don't have data. Empirical evidence or evidence-based research is very important to prevent narratives. When we don't have good data, what's happening is that even the GDP number, that's hugely extrapolated. And if you ask me what are the data which is outdated or whether the, you know, if you ask me, most of the components within the GDP calculation, that's outdated even a decade back. So we are extrapolating. So whatever number we are arrived at, this is a GDP or this is a growth, it's highly questionable. One, data is not okay, it's extrapolated. Second, the methodological revision happened. The way GDP was calculated before and now, there's a difference. Now, how the GDP is calculated, you know, you arrive at the value added, gross value added in different sectors, primary, secondary, tertiary, agriculture, manufacturing, and you need to look into each of the sectors where India has not grown, whether India has grown. So you see the tractor sales coming down, you see the monsoon dependent economy, agriculture is not working because monsoon failed. Despite of all the policies, agriculture sector is still depending on monsoons. So your agriculture sector is not working well. Then come down to the manufacturing, construction. Things are not doing well. You get into high frequency indicators and other indicators. In the post-pandemic space, even that's not working well. It's a service-led. Service is working. Then, you know, the narrative of the growth process over the years changed from consumption-led to investment-led. And now, if you look into the numbers, you can see the gross capital formation that has happened in the Indian economy due to the high capex. The government is spending on the high capex, so that led to the numbers shooting up. So we are calling it as a narrative that it is investment-led because it is the capital formation that's helping the Indian economy to move. If that's the case of the growth story, any withdrawal of the government from this capex formation by curtailing the spending will affect the economy recovery process. Because if that's an investment-led narrative, this is challenge. Second, if you look into the RBI, they are not in a mood to reduce the interest rate in the near future because we need to tackle many other composite things which I explained in terms of the tackling Western world and all. So interest rate is not going to be lower in the near future. So if such is the case, we need to identify what hasn't worked. In the post-pandemic fiscal space, nobody talked about NYAI or universal basic income transfers just because we thought that that's going to lead to the overheating of the economy and people will save more than they spent, so the basic transfers in the hands of the people will not work. But the narrative, the calculus of consent, if you look right now, there's a clear narrative about participation income and basic income now in the party propaganda. What Congress is projecting is that what has happened, there was a fiscal discipline. You have not enough spent enough to maintain the employment generation of your economy or the livelihood crisis is not met. So how to tackle this, you need to get into the universal basic income or the basic income. And if you ask me whether basic income or participation income, what is better, in the context of crisis, we need to resign the basic income transfers to the people. Otherwise, it's dignity that you're providing employment to people and the people will earn an income, participate in the economy. So the narrative of the economic policy, where is it right now? That's very important to look into. Previous chief economic advisor also you know, came up with this narrative of basic income transfers. And that's with that judicial combination of the participation income and basic income is crucial. Even the participation income, that was not a new policy in the context of India. It was much researched. The public act, activism, the public action that has translated into that public policy, which is a job guarantee. So that was a huge research in public action, which got translated into public policy. It's getting made. So what has not worked? Employment disability. There is widening inequalities which we have not addressed. And the competence within the government related to the growth recovery process or the social infrastructure and the social protection, these components, if you look into, we have not done yet, because just the way we need to maintain the fiscal space. So this is the way, this is the policy challenges, you know, as a second theme. What are the policy challenges? These are not easy. It's a public policy that coordination between center, bank, and the fiscal policy authorities needs to be done. And the poly crisis, the multiple crisis that's happening in the world is added to it. So we can't celebrate the growth numbers 7 to 8 at hand, and it also has base effect. Base effect is one thing, because if the economy has gone to a very low level of growth, level absolute value, so you can't celebrate growth, right? Growth is the rate of change. So as we have done very bad, even prior to the pandemic, the growth was not good, because we forgot 2019-20. Because we now started the narrative of the growth story from COVID onwards. But we should not forget that even prior to the COVID, we had challenges and concerns related to the low economic growth. So that's the way it is. Now let's open the floor, and if you have any questions, I can answer, and we can have a quick.
Story should not be celebrated, since there are a lot of negative elements in it. And you mentioned about capital flight also. But I have noticed that in the past 2-3 years, or even after globalization, in most of the years, the inflow of foreign money was positive compared to the outflow. For example, if we take the year 2023, April to December, the second half, the inflow was $19 billion. Outflow was something about $9 billion. Likewise, if we take year-wise data, we can see that inflow is high. Then how can you be afraid of outflow, since we have overcame even biggest challenges like COVID, demonetization, subprime crisis and all.
Thank you so much. That's exactly what I told, that we did an interest rate difference. We kept our interest rate in concomitant with the Western world's interest rate to prevent the capital flight at the cost of economic growth. You got the point? So we did an interest rate difference to protect the outflow. Over the years, as you mentioned, there is a tendency to move towards FDI, more stable inflow of things, rather than portfolio or what you call as foreign investors, the FII, foreign investors, institutional investors. That's a good trend. If there is a move from FII to FDI, they are attracting stable. And India attracted FDI, but if you look at the recent numbers, FDI numbers are not great. Even FDI is very good, very recent number. This is one thing. And your narrative of attracting the investment into India, that happened just because of the interest rate difference. I mentioned earlier also,
to avoid the capital flight, India did the interest rate hikes. Because we were that premium, i.e. for the Western world and i.e. for India, we always, you know, doing the interest rate difference to prevent the capital being flighted. That's exactly what I mentioned in my talk also, that we did interest rate difference to prevent the capital being flighted at the cost of economic growth recovery process, because economic growth recovery process required the low interest rates, but we kept the interest rate high to prevent the capital outflows. So we were protecting that hot money, because hot money always responds to high interest rates. So we kept our interest rate high to maintain the story, to attract more investment. Interest rate difference, that was our policy response.
Can I formulate question that he raised? Ma'am, once we compare India with China, we can see that most of this same. When we talk about the investment, compared to India, foreign direct investment is quite high in China. For example, once you look at, even though there is tussle between China and the USA, many of these issues, political issues, but China, USA is one of the biggest investors in this FDI investors in China. But at the same time, when we look at India, portfolio investment is quite high in India, but we are not able to attract FDI investment. So what are the important constraints that prevent us from, even though our political relationship with the US is quite strong, when we say that we are the largest democracy, two largest democracies in the world, but what are the important constraints that prevent India in attracting FDI investment to India compared to China?
Thank you. Related to the question we asked, in many discussions we mentioned that we can't replicate China. India can't be another China. And Jagdish Padavadi, Arvind Pankaria, who is the chairman of the 16th Finance Commission, there is a school of thought. They believe in that Make in India program of the manufacturing of the protectionism by focusing much more on the inward technology to replicate or to make India another China. It's not happening, that import substitution, the kind of policy, that narrative is entirely different from what India is doing right now. So, in a period like 2004 to 2006, there was a huge discussion that was happening related to the external sector, the exports, and getting to the import substitution regime. Because that will not work. Because we can't think that overnight when we get up, we will be another China. There are constraints in the way Indian economy can operate by getting a retreat from the globalization and focusing on the protectionism. So if that is a path, we tested it, but it didn't work. That Aatmanirbhar, that's well and good. Making India sufficient to face the competition of the global market is good, but at the same time, we can't be another China. That's the way we realized. Because on one way we commit to the international forums that there is no retreat in globalization. On other side, like China, if you get into the fiscal policy narratives of keeping the high tariffs, a tariff prevention to protect the internal economy, that's scale economy, that using the tariff as a fiscal tool to get into the protectionism. So there is an inconsistency over there. So these are the discussions.
Can I ask one more question? Actually, your talk itself, you raised a certain doubts about the data prepared by the agencies. Credibility question. So, my question is, how the international agencies perceive the data prepared by the governmental agencies, especially the statistical department? Mainly, why I ask this question is because there were certain reports earlier that even the Prime Minister tried to intervene in the reports prepared by the Finance Commission itself. So, how do the international agencies perceive the data prepared by the governmental agencies since 2014, if I specify the date?
Thank you so much. I will get into the data fundamentalism, which is a very provocative question. Before that, you know, let me ask, do we have enough time to take more questions? It is 11:30 right now, so this session can go up to 11:30. It's already 11:30. So how long we can go?
One more important concern about your personation is the telling that there is a shift from the consumption zone to investment level zone. But still, consumption plays a dominant role.
Of course, consumer confidence is very important. Yeah.
There is only a transition change. Transition period.
Yeah.
You cannot argue that it is a completely investment.
No, sir. I looked at the numbers, the GDP numbers, like private consumption spending, public consumption spending, public capital spending. So when I disagree with you, the growth story is happening, the component related to the capital spending but not consumption spending. And I'm equally worried like you, why there is no consumer confidence? So why the component is less in the economy?
Yeah. It gives the message that investment has started playing a dominant role.
Yeah, no, the narrative is there is a problem related to consumers' confidence. That's a way, I think we are on the same page. I'm worried about why there is no consumer, that confidence in the economy. Why it is investment led? Why it is not consumption led? Why the consumption related spending components are less? That's a concern. But now the growth story, if you look into the disaggregated, it's coming from GSE.
But we should be cautious in pointing out that the growth is highly investment.
Sure, well taken. But the data-driven analysis is investment-led. So that's it. So I will just answer quickly that data fundamentalism is an issue. Our surveys were not published because of certain concerns like the last mile connectivity of the government and the way we kept the data capture, it was not tallying. Then later on, it was released. That data fundamentalism is a serious concern. Second, data manipulation, unemployment. The important sources of the employment that figures came out right now is a periodic labor score survey and CMI. So we looked into these two sources of data to study the employment of unemployment. So if you ask me if I can look into that private agency CMI, the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy Data, that Vyas, Manoj Vyas agency and believe the numbers, if they are, the way, the methodology in which that data is constructed, getting constructed at the high frequency interval, whether that data is good or not, of course economists are aware of the issues related to CMI data. I'm aware of that. Otherwise, it's periodic labor force survey. So these are the two sources we studied. And periodic labor force survey reported that, things are happening, employment is happening, but when we disaggregated that data, it is a self-employment that is on the rise. And whether we should celebrate self-employment or whether it is a coping mechanism in which people are getting into self-employment or not, we need to ask that question. But employment, things are moving up, but when we disaggregated it, it is happening from the self-employment. So that's the periodic labor force survey data what is getting. So your question about political economy, they are yes and no to your concerns. First, to attract the mobile capital, we need to undertake certain policies in the Indian economy to attract the mobile capital. But it's a political stance whether the financial capitalization is the model of a growth process, if you ask me, I have my own concerns. But now that finance capital is given a lot of projection and the economy's policy narratives are completely influenced by that process of finance capital at the cost of the growth recovery process. So that political economy is well taken. Then the nuances about how to attract that investment, I will talk to you over a cup of tea because it's a highly controversial question you have asked. But also, looking into the personal traits of the leaders who were involved in the process, including the former finance minister. So those personal traits, of course, that influence. And it is a question the economists also ask, that purely economic factors are responsible for economic growth, or the personal traits of a leader affect economic growth. It's an important question. And in the public choice literature, it is clearly mentioned that the financial traits of central bank governor affects the outcome in terms of interest rate management. The fiscal deficit is getting manipulated or maneuvered will get affected by the person. finance minister, and educated leaders matter or not in Madeline's Besley's work, so that personal characteristics and the career theories of a leader, whether that affects economic growth. In my talk about the Indian growth story, should I confine to the economic factors or should I get into the personal traits of a leader in explaining economic growth? That's a serious concern. And it's another stream of literature which economists are aware and we are getting into those questions. So I stop here and over to you, sir. Thank you so much.